situation. So one question for Rosa is, who comes a little bit at the end of this panel, not the end of our conversation, to, you heard from what we said. You hear the challenges that we have in bringing localizing this network. How in this configuration that we're trying to have, building city to city cooperation, what do you, how do you see the role of the trade union movement and how it can contribute in a positive sense to this definition?
Thank you very much, Pierre. And thanks for inviting me also to this panel. I hope not to repeat what I said before. Maybe difficult for a representative of a global union federation of public service workers, where you know the idea of public servant, of civil servant, is encompassed, to speak about how workers and unions can contribute to sustainable and local economic development, and how this cooperation can improve working conditions for all. But I think that this is not a contradiction. Actually, this is the contradiction of our era. The fact that there's a global labor market that is trying to divide workers, protected workers from unprotected workers. There's a race to the bottom that is pushed by the globalization of markets, the financial interest of multinationals in reducing workers' rights and in allowing all kinds, all forms of abuses on workers. I mean, I think it's a shame that in 21st century we are still facing one of the biggest wave of slavery that we couldn't see in the past century, as we are witnessing in many countries. So the role of union is of course the role of bringing the principle of decent work, of collective bargaining, and the right to associate and to protect themselves from workers everywhere. But I think that this is also something that as public service workers we can bring, let's say, first of all as an example, because it's true that public workers are maybe among the most protected around the world, but it's also true that, that they are those suffering the strongest attack right now on their workers' rights and their working conditions. It's true that they have the know-how about making things work in a community and in a public administration. And sometimes we should look at that as an opportunity, as an investment, rather than a cost that needs to be cut. I just want to give you, from this point of view, an example, just to let you understand what I mean. We recently won, with our affiliates in Jakarta, a very important fight against the privatization of water, the management of water in Jakarta. The Supreme Court ruled affirming that the privatization and the contract that was subscribed with a private company by the governor of Jakarta was unconstitutional for two reasons. Before, it was in breach of the constitution that protects natural resources as an ownership of the country. And second, because this contract was completely, let's say, out of the market in terms of cost for the community, and because after 10 years, not a drop of drinkable water was distributed in Jakarta. So they decided to stop this. What happened? We were close and we were participating and asked to participate as experts, also in the trial in the Constitutional Court, in the process in the Constitutional Court, as public service workers international. And they asked, well, we need now to move to re-municipalize these services. How can we do? And so we said, well, let's also look around and see what we can do. And we asked to our colleagues in Buenos Aires, who passed through an experience like that, if the workers in Buenos Aires and the management of the company of water in Buenos Aires can help Jakarta to go back to these public services. Well, there's still a legal case ongoing, but this is the way public services under the public administration that care about governance, that care about governance can bring added value that sometimes the private focused only on its own profit cannot bring. And then there's the issue of formalizing the informal sector. Well, I don't know if this will be possible everywhere, but for sure, public service workers and public administration and local government mainly have a fundamental role, because these are the actors that, even if it will not be possible to formalize the informal work, can make accessible fundamental human and working rights to the informal sector workers, because we have the possibility to acknowledge some social security to these workers, some better working condition, as was explained right now. But let me tell you, just to conclude, that these are the things that of the day-to-day work. I think that we need to be ambitious, because the challenges are very high. And city-to-city cooperation, in my view, should aim, and this is a call on you that I launch, should aim to look at the challenges of this century. Why don't develop city-to-city cooperation to target the issue of energy, as in many countries is happening now with the creation of small cooperatives using renewable, local-based, in order to meet the objective of COP21. Why don't we look into protecting from the depredation of multinational and the multilateral treaty agreements, natural resources and public services that are actually one of the fundamental tools to redistribute wealth in the world. I mean, we made a research last year through our research unit at the University of Greenwich, where it comes out that public services are representing 76% of the disposable income for the 20 poorest percent of population in the OECD country. That means it will be much more in developing country. So we need to think and to consider that helping each other in this local experience as public administration and public service workers can make the difference also in the redistribution of wealth. Thank you.